Welcome to Exchange's Deep Dive, The Battle for Our Screens, a four-part miniseries on our Exchanges at Goldman Sachs podcast. I'm Jake Siewert, Global Head of Corporate Communications here at the firm. The pandemic has made our real lives virtual, accelerating our dependence on devices and online platforms for entertainment, work, and social connection. With that comes a new chapter in the competition for our digital lives. In this four-part miniseries, we're going to talk to experts from across Goldman Sachs about how our online behaviors changed, how companies are responding to that shift, and what trends from the pandemic may be here to stay. The first episode will focus on entertainment. You'll hear about changes in streaming and movie theaters from Brett Feldman in our research division, Adam Agress in our asset management division, and Alekhya Uppalapati from our investment bank. After you've listened to this one, be sure to check out the other three episodes in the Battle for Our Screens miniseries about work, social connection, and tech regulation. Hope you enjoy. First up, here's Heath, Terry, and Brett Feldman from Goldman Sachs Research to give us the data on streaming trends.
Brett, thanks for taking the time to join us. So let's start by setting the stage. This pandemic has obviously changed a lot about the way we're all going about our daily lives, including the way that we get our entertainment. How have you seen it impact the way that people are getting entertained, and what numbers are you watching to gauge that?
Yeah, thanks, Heath. Good question. So one of the key things we're paying attention to is cord cutting, which is people canceling their cable and satellite TV subscriptions. And just to frame what's going on here, on an annual basis, every quarter for the last 8 years, we have seen the total universe of pay TV subscribers decline from a peak of a little over 100 million households early in 2012 to about 85 million households as of the most recent quarter. So that represents an aggregate decline of about 13% over that period, which doesn't sound too severe. That's about 1% or 2% decline every year over that period. But you have to realize half of those subscriber losses have occurred during just the last 12 months, with the second quarter of this year being the worst ever for cord cutting, with the universe declining by nearly 8% on a year-on-year basis. So what that means is that in the second quarter of this year, nearly 2 million households canceled a cable or satellite TV subscription. Or another way of thinking about it is that 22,000 households cut the cord every single day. I mean, obviously, why are they doing this? They're streaming more. And during the initial phase of the lockdown, data suggests that streaming usage was up 100% year on year. So people are getting rid of their pay TV services because they have more streaming options available to them.
That's great. I mean, obviously, streaming has been a major source of the shift in entertainment that we're seeing. Are there some numbers that you would put around the context or put some context around the growth that we've seen in streaming?
Yeah, I mean, you cover Netflix, so you know this, but just in the most recent quarter, you know, downloads of that app were up 25% year on year. And we've also seen third-party data suggesting that consumers have increased the number of streaming services they subscribe to just during a lockdown by about 25%, which means they went from 3 to 4, but that's still a fairly significant increase over a short period of time. But I think that also was what's interesting is that it's really not just the traditional video business that has seen some disruption here as digital platforms grow, particularly as digital platforms become more important during this lockdown period. The movie business has been dramatically reshaped by the pandemic. Just a few weeks ago, AMC Theaters, which is the largest theater chain in the world, and Universal Pictures reached a new agreement where Universal now has the right to release its movies exclusively in AMC theaters for as few as 17 days. That's effectively 3 weekends in the theaters. For context, the historical model has been that movies would be exclusively in theaters for 70 to 90 days, which means that 18 days after a new movie is released, you could theoretically purchase that and watch it in your living room. And we have seen that happen during the pandemic because the theaters have been closed. And so the major studios have had no choice but to go ahead and take some of their content and release it directly on streamed platforms. In fact, 22% of consumers paid to stream a first-run movie during the pandemic. And of those who did, 90% said that they would do it again. And the studios are clearly aware of this. Now, let's just look at what Disney has announced and intend to do. They have a live-action remake of Mulan that would have been released earlier this year. Instead, they've made a decision that they are not going to release it in theaters unless theaters happen to be open, but they're not open in the U.S., and it's going to be available for purchase for $29.99 exclusively on the Disney Plus streaming platform. So you have to be a subscriber of Disney Plus to have the right to purchase this. It's going to be a really interesting experiment. But what Disney has already seen is that if they release theatrical content directly and exclusively onto Disney Plus, it does seem to help. They seem to have had a lot of success taking Hamilton, which was supposed to be in the theaters next year, and moving it directly to Disney Plus earlier this year. And data suggests that Disney Plus downloads were 74% higher before that content became available. And we're seeing it across all the other studios as well. Comcast released Trolls World Tour direct to premium video on demand. Disney also brought Artemis Fowl directly to Disney Plus. And the SpongeBob movie is going to be going directly to premium video on demand, released by Viacom early next year. Just to put some numbers around this, I'm going to throw one at you, $100 million. That's how much revenue Universal generated when they released Trolls World Tour directly as a premium video on demand purchase instead of taking it to theaters as they intended because the theaters were closed. When you do that, you actually make a much higher margin as a studio. So we estimate that Universal kept about $75 million of those rental fees as their revenue. In order for them to have had the same revenue success with Trolls if it had been released in the theaters, they would have had to do about double. In other words, they would have had to do over $150 million at box office in order to keep about $75 million for themselves. So I think that what these studios have learned so far, and granted that the lockdown is a unique period, is that they don't even need to replicate the commercial success of their movies that they would have seen in the theaters in order to have the same financial returns to them as a studio.
It's fascinating. You know, obviously streaming and movies, we're seeing this shift in a pretty meaningful way. But one of the other bigger beneficiaries, I have to imagine, has been gaming. You know, you see this across a lot of points in your coverage, covering both the networks as well as many of the platforms that create these games. What are you seeing there?
Yeah, that's a great point. You're right. We don't just look at the media companies. We also closely follow some of the network operators. And Verizon, which is the largest wireless provider in the country, said that they saw a 100% increase in gaming on its network back in April, which was the front end of the lockdown period. There's also some data suggesting that consumers spent over $19 billion on mobile games in just the second quarter of this year alone. That's the largest quarter ever. And it's not just the heavy gamers who are part of that. Casual gaming seems to be up by about 40% year on year through the first half of this year. And it's not just the games on the gaming platforms that are more popular. Just earlier this year, 12 million concurrent players attended a Travis Scott concert on Fortnite. So people are going to the gaming platforms, not just for gaming entertainment, but increasingly for other forms of digital entertainment as well.
Well, and it's not just the people watching the games. You also have the people watching the gamers, you know, on platforms right, like Twitch and others, consuming hundreds of millions of hours globally, up over 100% this year or during this pandemic, just to be able to watch people play games.
That's right.
So, you know, obviously this is a market that even before the pandemic was set to grow massively with major new streaming services launching over the first half of this year. What does the streaming market look like for a consumer who's got to try and figure all this out?
So there are over three dozen streaming video services that consumers can subscribe to. It's actually considerably more than three dozen. We recently looked at this and cut it off at three dozen because it was becoming too cluttered. And the prices range from free for ad-supported services to maybe $15 or a little less than $15 a month for a subscription video on demand service. It can go up to $35 to $85 a month if you want a live channel bundle, so something that resembles cable but that you stream it through the internet. Or you could also spend maybe $90 to $130 per year if you're looking for a sports-specific streaming package. So in this recent report we had, we created this interactive exhibit to help show our clients how they can potentially narrow down what type of streaming service they would want based on what they're looking for. Are they looking for live TV or premium content or sports or not having to watch ads? But the point is that no matter how much you try to narrow down this group, you end up with too many options and none of them are directly comparable. So it's still a very confusing environment out there for the consumer.
Yeah, I can only imagine. When you think about that, though, how many of these services are people willing to pay for before they hit subscription fatigue?
Let's go back and just focus on the video market and go back to setting the stage just to think about what's going on. When you ask, why are people cutting the cord? Well, they're streaming more. They're also, by definition, watching less regular TV. And in the second quarter of this year, during the lockdown, when everyone was home and they had nothing else to do but to look at the screen, broadcast primetime ratings were still down 26% in the second quarter. Even if you exclude sports, because obviously there was no sports to watch, those broadcast ratings were still down 15% year on year in the second quarter. And by the way, that's with news ratings being up 86%. So what's my point? People are clearly watching a lot less television. The reason that's relevant, the reason why it comes back to your question, is that even though people are still watching a lot less television, there are still, as I said earlier, 85 million pay TV households out there. They're each paying about $90 a month for the service, which means that even in this cord-cutting environment, about $90 billion a year is being paid for subscription traditional television. On top of that, advertisers are still spending about $60 billion a year on TV advertising. So that means that there's about $150 billion a year of revenue being generated in the traditional pay TV market. That is a huge amount of money that could potentially be reallocated into other forms of digital entertainment. So while your question is a great one, people already subscribe to all these different services, they're still spending collectively $90 billion a year on pay TV that could potentially be spent on other subscription video services or other forms of subscription digital entertainment. And advertisers can still go ahead and subsidize an additional $60 billion worth of ad-supported digital content if they were to gradually take that money out of the traditional pay TV ecosystem where the subscriber base and viewership is declining and move it over to the services that people are currently adopting. So I know it seems crazy to think that you might have room for more subscription-based services, but you can probably afford it and advertisers can probably afford to reach you on those platforms even if you're not willing to pay for it yourself.
That definitely makes sense. I mean, obviously the numbers are there. So when you look at all of those providers, three dozen in your math alone, how do you figure out which ones are going to survive? What does it take for one of those platforms to get to the scale or the escape velocity that they need to be able to get to in order to make it in a world that's dominated by companies like Netflix and Disney?
Yeah, it's a good question. And it's another thing that we spend a considerable amount of time thinking about, because when you have such a fragmented and confusing landscape, you really have to have a couple of key success factors as an entertainment company in order to rise above that noise. And we've identified five factors, and they all start with the letter B conveniently. So we call them the five key success factors, the five B's of direct to consumer. And here's what they are. The first one is brand. If you don't have a widely recognized brand, particularly a globally recognized brand, you're going to initially have a lot of difficulty rising above the clutter. The second is breadth, meaning distribution. You have to be able to reach consumers wherever they are, not just in the US, but globally. The third is build, meaning you have to have production capabilities. If you don't have the ability to create content, you're going to be trying to purchase it in a market where there is significant demand and significant cost inflation for that content. We think you need a backlist, which means you need a deep content library. Heath, as you know, people typically sign up for services because of the original content, but they tend to stick around because of the library content. And lastly, you need a strong balance sheet. It costs a lot of money to build these platforms. And that's because you're not typically just trying to reach a US audience. You're trying to reach a global audience. And so it's really, these are the attributes you need if you think you might try to become the next Netflix. The point you made earlier, we agree Disney is probably the only standalone traditional media company that I think has clearly demonstrated that they possess all five of these characteristics. In fact, you can make the case that they're number one in all of those categories. And a lot of people don't know this, but Disney already has over 100 million people who subscribe to some form of a streaming service from them. After that, it gets a lot harder. I think many of the traditional media companies are going to find that it's very difficult in order to scale up and have success in a market dominated by companies like Netflix and Disney. We happen to think Viacom, CBS might have more of a fighting chance than people give them. But I would say that there's really no consensus among investors yet around who else can get to that level of scale.
So one of the other big areas of entertainment that's been impacted in this environment is theme parks. And obviously, that's a big part of Disney's business. It's a big part of Universal's business. How do you see theme parks adjusting to all of this? And is there a future where we're, you know, back in packed parks and standing in long lines for turkey legs and rides on roller coasters?
Yeah, well, I mean, theme parks are intrinsically an analog experience, right? You got to be there in person. So I don't think there's ever going to be a digital version of that. And it's one of the reasons why we do think that the companies that are leaders in this category, most notably Disney, but as you pointed out, also Universal, I think are ultimately going to kind of get back to their fighting shape whenever we are fully through this pandemic. you know, as you think about people sitting around talking about what they want to do as soon as they can do things, I imagine a lot of families are saying, we're going to head down to Orlando and go see Mickey as soon as we possibly can. But that's another example of where there can be a crossover between a company's digital business and their analog businesses, which is when you go to Disney World, some of those attractions you're seeing are attractions based on their content, like Star Wars. And so I think what you're going to see is you're going to see more of a tie-in between not only the theatrical films, which may actually still go to theaters to some degree in the future, series around the same franchise that are exclusive to their streaming platform, and then an experience, a real experience you can have around the same exact content when you go to their parks. And it may even create a degree of operating and advertising efficiency where you can use that audience that's logging in on a regular basis to watch your key franchise content on a streaming platform to alert them that we now have a new real live experience you can go and have when you go down to our park. And I do think that the next step in some of these platforms, particularly for companies like Disney that are in more than one business, is to evolve the streaming products, not just from a platform to watch a movie or a TV show, but maybe to become an e-commerce platform. And in a sense, you're seeing Disney experiment that with Mulan, where they're saying, even though you're already a subscriber to the service, we are giving you the opportunity to purchase another experience from us, an early premium experience from us. And I think that's going to be a huge event for them if it finds out that their customer base is very interested in that.
Great. Brett, thanks so much for taking the time to join us. It's been fascinating.
Happy to do it.
Thanks, Heath and Brett. Next, we're going to hear about the other side of streaming, how movie theaters are responding, and the shifting balance of power in the industry, from Adam Agress in Goldman Sachs Asset Management.
My name is Adam Agress. I work at Goldman Sachs in the CIMD division, or the Goldman Sachs Asset Management division. My team focuses on investing capital in equities, and I specifically focus on the media and consumer sector. Prior to COVID, the movie industry was already seeing pressure from consumer preference shifts towards streaming services. So you've seen hours spent on streaming services go up substantially. At the same time, we're seeing volumes of ticket sales declining over the last two decades, really. Since 2002, ticket sale volumes are down about 20%. And even in 2019, it was down 5%. So the movie industry has seen that volume pressure, but has been able to offset it with price increases. But, you know, it's clear the consumer preferences are shifting and people are increasingly watching more TV at home through these streaming services. You've seen studio profitability be pressured as a result because the same streaming services are investing heavily in content and driving up the cost of films. And this really came to a head last year when Netflix started introducing premium featured films. So historically, Netflix really focused on scripted TV. And then in 2019, added to that some really well-done premium feature films such as The Irishman, Marriage Story, Two Popes. In fact, Netflix had 24 Oscar nominations last year, the most of any studio. So it was clear that Netflix was starting to go after the movie industry even pre-COVID, and that streaming was something that was going to be a competitive threat for the movie industry going forward. So even though the streaming services are a clear competitive threat to the movie industry, you've seen theaters actually do reasonably well over the last few years because they've been able to offset the volume declines with price increases at both the ticket level and concessions, and then also offering some premium services like better seating. The studios have struggled more, though, because they haven't had those offsets. And if you exclude Disney, which is the largest studio, the remaining studios all combined made less than half of the top three theaters in 2019. So it was clear that theaters are getting a bigger piece of the pie. And part of that is the historical economic relationship between theaters and movies. Theaters get more than half the profits of a movie ticket sale, despite having spent no money on the production or the marketing expenses, which all are spent by the studios. And so really the theaters have had the leverage. They've had exclusive rights to distribution for up to 3 months after a movie is released. And so the studios have really not had many offsets to the volume declines that have suffered the industry. And so, you know, going into COVID, we were already seeing tension between theaters and movie studios. But I think with the onset of the pandemic, you've seen a real shift in dynamics in the industry. And the reason being that today, with the pandemic going on, theaters are closed. And so the studios have really needed to figure out creative ways to distribute their content to recoup the investments they've made in the movies they produced. And so they're really looking at different avenues of distribution beyond the theaters in order to monetize those movies. Historically, as I mentioned before, theaters have had 90-day exclusivity on any movie release. But during COVID, you've seen studios start to explore other distribution avenues. Two other options outside of the theater distribution are on-demand video, which we've all experienced at home, and that usually happens about 3 or 4 months after a movie's released in the theaters. But what we're exploring today is more premium on-demand, which enables the consumer to watch the film at home for $20 or more in and around when the movie's being released in the theaters. And the other option for studios is distributing on their own streaming services. Most of the studios are associated with large conglomerates that have streaming services. Great examples of this are Disney Studios with Disney Plus, Warner Brothers with HBO Max, Paramount on CBS Access, and Universal Studios, which has access to Comcast Peacock. And so, you know, today, lucky for the studios, they have multiple ways they can distribute the films. And with theaters shuttered, the theater companies really have little leverage to stop them from doing so. And the first example of this was with Trolls World Tour, which was produced by Universal Studios, which they released on demand at the same time that it was released in theaters. At the time in the spring, theaters were already being shut down. So really the only way to watch the movie was video on demand. And so Universal Studios offered Trolls at home viewing for about $20 per viewing. And it ended up being a huge success for Universal Studios, who grossed over $100 million of revenue from this video on demand. And while that's less than the gross revenue that Trolls, the original movie, made in theaters, it actually was more profitable for Universal Studios because they get a much bigger cut of the profit from video on demand. So for a purchase at home, they make 80% of the revenue, while in theaters, they get less than half. And so while the gross revenue was lower, it was still more profitable for Universal Studios. And as a result, they said that they were going to explore doing more video on demand releases simultaneously with theater releases, which rustled a lot of feathers within the theater industry. In fact, AMC came out and said that if Universal were to do that, they would not carry Universal films going forward. And there was obviously a lot of back and forth, but they did come to a watershed agreement in recent weeks. And I believe this new agreement between Universal and AMC could set a new standard in the industry. And the idea is that movies will be exclusively distributed in theaters for 17 days instead of 90 days, which is the first 3 weekends of a release. And after that time, it can be released on premium video on demand, which has to be $20 or more per viewing, and that theaters will get some share of the profit from the premium video on demand, but will no longer have exclusivity beyond that 17-day window. And, you know, we think this is definitely a win for the studios. They spend a lot of money marketing a film when it is first released in theaters, and then it ends up not being top of mind when it's released the regular video on demand 3 to 4 months later. And so what this enables them to do is leverage all that investment they do up front and monetize it at home at a much higher level when it's still relevant to consumers. And so this will be an added stream of revenue for the studios at much higher margins and should help them become more profitable, especially on the more marginal films. It's a big question mark how it's going to affect the theaters. I think AMC believes that because of the profit share, they can offset the cannibalization from people watching more at home versus theaters. But the extent to which people are going to want to watch films more at home is unknown at this point, and theaters will lose that concession revenue that's very profitable for them when people attend the theaters. And so I think it is a big question mark going forward how it will affect the theaters. But I think once the cat is out of the bag, this is going to become the standard and you're going to see more studios and theaters come to similar agreements. Another example of premium video on demand is Disney, who recently announced that they're going to break the mold and release Mulan, which is one of their larger feature films planned for 2020, on Disney Plus. And so on September 4th, you're going to be able to watch Mulan on Disney Plus for $30 per viewing. It will also be released in theaters where they are open around the world, although there's very few theaters open at this time in the United States. while Disney has said this is a one-off, I think it could give them information about a new business model where they release simultaneously on Disney Plus for a premium. And why this is particularly exciting for Disney is not only will they get the $30 premium from the video, but it could drive higher subscriber growth where there's a lot of value add. And so this new approach by Disney is a pretty big threat to the theaters, because in this example, they do not share any of the profits with the theaters for any of the premium video on demand revenue. And so I think it's going to push the theaters into making more agreements faster, because Disney is such a powerful studio. And if they show that they can go around the theaters and still be profitable, it's a real threat to the industry. And so this wouldn't have been possible prior to COVID. I think everyone has to relook at how they run their businesses. And more than ever, studios have lots of options on how they distribute their films. And so that stronghold that the theaters had on the movie industry in the past is starting to loosen. And I think the real implications of this going forward is those companies with scale have a clear advantage. And because of that, they have the most optionality around how they distribute their films, whether it's through their own streaming services, through video on demand, through third parties, or through theaters. And so increasingly, they're going to have leverage and be able to reinvest in their businesses and grow the most. I think the biggest question mark is for theaters, who it's unclear how much cannibalization there'll be as a result of a shortened window. And if volumes decline, they'll be less relevant of a distribution channel for the studios. And therefore, you could see the studios push more into streaming and video on demand. And so I think they're having to rethink their business. I think they need to make sure they get a piece of that streaming revenue going forward to survive. But I think that industry could struggle going forward as a result of these changes in the industry. One interesting dynamic is recently the DOJ made a motion to end the 1940 Paramount consent decree. And what that was a consent decree signed over 70 years ago that said that movie studios could not own theaters. And the reason for that is, from a competitive standpoint, they didn't want the studios to control the distribution. With the advent of streaming, the courts decided that that was no longer relevant. And so now content owners can own theaters. And one interesting dynamic could be is some of these large studios decide that they actually want to own the distribution physically and buy some of the theaters and make that into a whole experience into itself that could drive brand awareness and create a whole 360 consumer experience. And so no one's discussed doing that, but it is something that could happen where you see vertical integration. And if the theater companies get into trouble as a result of some of the financial pressures, that's something that could be explored by some of the larger studios.
Thanks, Adam. And now for our final perspective on this topic, we're going to hear from Alekhya Uppalapati in our Tech, Media, and Telecom Group, or TMT, in the Investment Banking Division. Alekhya is going to give us a snapshot on deal activity and what she's hearing from her corporate clients. Welcome, Alekhya. The streaming services are realizing a big tailwind, obviously through COVID, more people at home. How are streaming companies growing and evolving in this environment with such outsized demand?
You're right. I mean, streaming engagement has reached unprecedented levels throughout this period. I saw a stat recently that streaming viewership has doubled during COVID versus pre-COVID. So during the end of March to middle of May, streaming was at 20 billion plus hours versus 10 billion hours during that same period in 2019, which is pretty remarkable. And we've seen that, you know, not only for subscription video platforms such as Netflix and Disney, but also for the user-generated platforms such as TikTok and Twitch and YouTube. You know, apparently viewers spent over 1.7 billion hours watching live stream content on Twitch in May, which was nearly double how much was spent in December. Some very interesting changes across that ecosystem. You know, interestingly, the streaming space has also evolved over the last few months, and we're seeing increased competition from new entrants with a variety of different business models. For example, on the subscription video on, you know, on demand front, AT&T launched HBO Max in May. That service has accumulated already over 4 million account activations. On the ad-supported side, Comcast launched their Peacock platform in July, where they've had already 10 million signups by the end of Q2. And you saw Quibi earlier this year launching its mobile first hybrid ad / subscription video on demand platform. So, you know, a number of new entrants into the ecosystem. We've also seen that consumers have been using this period to really sample a broad variety of streaming services. So, and many of the streaming services offered free trials as part of that, but 8% of US broadband households reported that they subscribed to at least one new OTT service since COVID began. And roughly 70% of people who signed up for a free trial have actually subscribed to one of the services that they've tried. Look, I think the other thing I would note is that the rise of AVOD and live streaming video services and the continued growth in gaming have all increased competition across the streaming ecosystem. And so it's even more critical to deliver high quality content to drive retention. And how is that high quality content defined? It's, you know, sometimes that's in the form of new and exclusive, large budget production. Sometimes that's in the form of really well-known library content. And sometimes it's in the form of going really deep in particular verticals that consumers might be interested in.
So yeah, there's demand for high quality content. Obviously, user-generated content, people may have more time on their hands to generate content, but it's awfully hard to produce new content right now. And seeing big production shutdowns in a lot of, you know, traditional Hollywood for sure. How's that production shutdown or slowdown affecting the industry that needs more content right now?
Yeah, I think that people underestimate the size and the complexity of the production process. Just as you think about the number of people it takes working together to produce the incredible content that we as a consumer get to experience, whether it's in theaters or cable TV or streaming services, it's a big effort. So safety is clearly the priority as these new productions get into play. But also note that, you know, there's increased expenses required as part of those new protocols, daily COVID testing, et cetera. And there's going to be new safety rules that require potentially on-set COVID safety officers to enforce those protocols, frequent cleaning of areas and equipment, potentially limiting filming hours and creating zones to separate crews that they can't already socially distance or wear masks. So I think it is coming back over the course of the next couple of months here, but it's certainly going to be in a, you know, a more complicated and more expensive endeavor to do so.
So given the rapid growth we've seen in the sector, that usually means that we'll see some deal activity. Well, what kinds of deals do you think we'll be seeing in this sector as we go forward?
Well, you know, there's fewer streaming companies out there than one may think. Most platforms have been built organically within the large media companies. For example, Disney with Disney Plus, CBS All Access, HBO Max, Peacock. Of course, those companies may have done some acquisitions for technologies, et cetera, to build those platforms. There have been a few platforms that have been acquired over the last several years. Viacom bought Pluto TV, Fox bought Tubi earlier this year. But really, I would say over the last several years, the large transactions have been in the form of large media companies, you know, as they continue to focus on direct-to-consumer and OTT, focusing on acquiring the premium IP that's required to attract subscribers as they continue to scale. So, of course, the Disney-Fox merger, AT&T, Time Warner, Discovery Scripts have been, you know, the most prominent transactions over the last few years.
So you also cover the theater industry, obviously been very hard hit due to COVID, and any kind of place where you gather is having challenges. How do you think that industry is going to evolve, and what might it look like going forward as hopefully we get the pandemic behind us?
Yeah, but the film slate from the major studios has been constant motion since the pandemic, you know, took hold with a number of big franchise films such as Bond and Fast and Furious very early on being pushed into later in the year or even into 2021. And of course, some films, you know, bypassing the theatrical window entirely and going directly to streaming. You know, as the theaters begin to reopen, there's a huge focus on safety for consumers. So AMC, Regal, Cinemark, IMAX, Marcus, everyone's unveiled new cinema safe protocols to really make sure that they're universally applying a new set of protocols similar to the production industry, as I talked about, but also into the actual consumer experience of that in across the movie theaters. So for example, these protocols are going to make masks mandatory, enforce social distancing, you know, update air filtration, sell tickets electronically, modify concessions, among other things.
So a lot of the attention gets focused on U.S. subscribers, and that is the core for many of these businesses. But describe briefly kind of how the international growth looks like for streaming.
Yeah, it's a great question. Look, international expansion remains a key growth vector for all of the streaming platforms. You know, Netflix is a perfect example. They added over 20 million net subscribers in the first half of 2020 to now have over 190 million subscribers globally.
Thanks, Alekhya. Great to hear from you. That concludes this episode of Exchange's Deep Dive, The Battle for Our Screens. Thanks for listening, and please tune in to our next episode in this miniseries about how work from home life has changed our productivity and what we can expect from work in a post-pandemic world. This podcast was recorded throughout the month of August and September in the year 2020. Thanks for listening.
All price references and market forecasts correspond to the date of this recording.
This podcast should not be copied, distributed, published, or reproduced in whole or in part. The information contained in this podcast does not constitute research or a recommendation from any Goldman Sachs entity to the listener. Neither Goldman Sachs nor any of its affiliates makes any representation or warranty as to the accuracy or completeness of the statements or any information contained in this podcast, and any liability therefor, including in respect of direct, indirect, or consequential loss or damage, is expressly disclaimed. The views expressed in this podcast are not necessarily those of Goldman Sachs, and Goldman Sachs is not providing any financial, economic, legal, accounting, or tax advice or recommendations in this podcast. In addition, the receipt of this podcast by any listener is not to be taken as constituting the giving of investment advice by Goldman Sachs to that listener, nor to constitute such person a client of any Goldman Sachs entity.